Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Leaders' Dedication Service. Any visitors are particularly welcome. You'll have the usual cup of tea or coffee and light refreshments after the service in the foyer, so please come and join us and make sure you make yourself known. The normal sheet is not here this morning. I have a special copy. But having said that, normally we have the ones that say everything's on as normal. In this case, it's not, because if you remember, the schools are off. So if you're not sure whether your organisation is on or off, speak to the leader. The service this evening is at the usual time of 6:30, and Martin Hampton will be speaking. Just a note for the leaders of the house groups. The books are at the back of the church just now. Please collect them for your group and distribute them and agree with them the date for your first meeting. The session would encourage as many people as possible to participate in the Bible studies. However, we're here to worship God, aren't we? So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we have come here to worship you this morning, to speak with you, to read your word, and hear it explained. Be close to us as we pray just now, and help us to worship in spirit and in truth. We ask this in and through the Lord Jesus, our Saviour and Master. Amen. Our first praise this morning is stand up for Jesus. So let's do that, and let's all stand and sing. Looking at last week's. Can't get the staff, can you? We're now there's a higher floor, aren't we?
Danny, they changed the first
one. Oh, did they? Oh, right, sorry.
At least you and I knew what we were singing. Okay, so let's start again, shall we? Let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Today is our dedication service for our leaders of our youth organisations. This is a really important service, actually, for it does two things. First of all, it recognises our leaders and it helps you see who our leaders of our youth organisations. We have two uniformed youth organisations and two non-uniformed organisations. We have the Boys Brigade and the Girls Brigade, and we have the SID Kids, and we have our youth club. And it's important that you know who the leaders are. And the reason for that is we want you to be praying for our leaders, that they might know God's goodness in their life and they may know God's wisdom as they share with the boys and girls the things of Jesus. And so that's the first thing we want you to do. We want you to pray for them. But the second reason why we're having a dedication service is as a church, we are dedicating them over for God's service. And what they do is of vital importance. I was down at Dundella yesterday and I was talking to the treasurer of Dundella. And I was telling him about the service. And he said, you know, I belonged to Strand for 16 years. And I says, Harry, you didn't belong to Strand for 16 years. In fact, I remember I saw you one time in the Methodist and you said that you have your non-attendance at the Methodist. I says, what do you mean you belong to Strand for 16 years? He says, Danny, I was in the BB for 16 years. And I came away and I thought about it and I thought, for Harry, for 16 years, Strand was his church. He probably never or very seldom came to church. But for 16 years he came here and he had fellowship here. Not as a Christian, but as a boy in the Boys Brigade. He had influenced during that time and he said it was really important to him. He really enjoyed being part of the BB here. And I thought there's many, many children that we would love to see to come to Christ. But while they're still children, we have a great influence over them as they come to SID Kids and Youth Club, as they come to Boys Brigade and Girls Brigade. And therefore, it's right and proper that we dedicate our officers and our leaders to the work of Christ. They have an opportunity. For some, it's 16 years. For others, it may only be 3 months. But while the children come to these organisations, our leaders have a great responsibility, and that's to share the love of Christ and what they say and how they act and their love towards the boys and the girls. And so it's right and proper that we dedicate them to this vital work here in the church. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read out the names of the leaders and officers. When I read your name, you don't have to come to the front, but if you just stand up, if you don't mind where you are, and then I'm going to pray that the Lord might bless you. So I read your name, if you would just stand up where you are. When being with the Boys Brigade, our captain is David Doggart. Then we have Sam Kennedy, Elaine Bush, Murray Hampton, Linda Ellis, Robin Quinlan, and Caroline Neal. For the Girls Brigade, we have Suzanne Howe, Susan Lilly, Estelle Matthews, Dawn Rankin. For SID Kids, we have Linda Ellis, Robin Quinlan, and Caroline Neal. And for the Youth Club, Linda Ellis. You're standing up a lot, Linda. Robin Quinlan, Celia Kennedy, and John Johnson. It's always good to have someone come in late. Lovely to see you there. Perfect, perfect. Let's all pray together. Father God, first of all, we want to come and want to thank you for the dedication of our officers and leaders. For some, they've only really just started. We think of the Girls Brigade in particular. They've only just started from September. But the Boys Brigade and the SID Kids and Youth Club have been going on for many years. And for many of these folks standing, they've committed themselves for years and years to reach out to the boys and the girls of this area. And so, Lord, we want to first of all thank you for them. We thank you for their dedication. We thank you for the love they have for you. And we thank you, Lord, for how you've blessed them over the years. Thank you for the great influence they've had over children. And many of the influences they have, Lord, we have no idea about. If it wasn't for the fact that I was talking to Harry yesterday, We would not have known about Harry for 16 years, how he felt that he belonged to Strand. He felt that Strand was his home place because of the work of the Boys' Brigade. And so, Lord, we thank you for them. But the name of Jesus, Lord, we dedicate them to your service. We pray that over this next year that you would be with them as they spend time with the boys and the girls in this area. That, Father, you will help them to be wise, help them to be patient, keep them well, and bless them and their families. Fill them with your Spirit that they will be the people of power that you've called them to be. And that, Father, we want to pray that they will have the privilege this year of leading boys and girls to you. The boys and girls in this area will come and find you as their Lord and Savior because of the dedication of our leaders here. So be with them and bless them, we ask. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much.
Hey, boys and girls, can I leave for Sunday Pals? Let us again praise God in our second hymn, There Is a Hope. Let's stand and sing. Let's again unite our hearts in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, once again we come to you in prayer. We thank you and worship you together. You are the maker and sustainer of all things. We think of all the good things that you have provided for us. We thank you and the many blessings you have showered on us over our lifetimes, and also how you continue to bless us. We thank you that you're a great God, the only true God, the one to be praised and adored, yet also our Father, who knows and loves each one of us individually, despite our failings. You are the one who is slow to anger and great in mercy. Lord, we particularly thank you for the Lord Jesus and what he's done for us through his life, his death, and his resurrection. Help us to keep him first in our lives. Father, forgive us for our self-centered lives. Lord, it's so easy for us to watch the tragedies in this world, to think about them maybe for a few moments, and then go on as if nothing has happened, and live our lives as though we are the only ones that matter. Lord, at this time, we think of others in your world who are living in places where there's turmoil and war, for those who have been displaced and living as refugees, often in desperate conditions, and for those in our own area who are going to a lost eternity. Forgive us, Lord, for our carelessness. Help us, Lord, to have hearts like yours. Help us to be generous, even as we think of what the Lord Jesus did for you, that while we were yet sinners, he reconciled us to you. Fill our hearts with that compassion and use our hands, our time, our actions as you would lead. We bring our prayers to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our reading this morning is from Acts chapter 12, starting at verse 25 and reading through to chapter 13, verse 5. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking with them John, also called Mark. In the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshipping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. The two of them went on their way by the Holy Spirit and went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. When they arrived in Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues. John was with them as their helper. Amen. Before Danny comes to speak to us, folks, we'll stand again to sing, "All to Jesus I Surrender." Let's stand to sing.
Thank you.
These six verses mark a big change in the book of Acts. Really, up before this, Acts was telling us mainly about the early church, really about early church and Peter. And from these verses on, it changes. Peter becomes less important, and it talks about the early church really with Paul, and that's the significance of these six verses, actually. But in these six verses, it also gives us a quick snapshot of the church at Antioch. And I just thought for a minute or two, I want to think about four things that we can learn from this church. Since it's to do with our leaders' dedication service, it tells us four things about the leadership within our church and the fellowship within our church. And we'll have a wee look at that this morning. The first thing it tells us is when we read this, most of the names that we read about, we don't really know who they are. They're not particularly important. But what is obvious is that these are folk from mixed backgrounds and mixed races. You've got John Mark, who we know is the writer of Mark's Gospel. He's a young Jewish boy. And then it mentions a couple of folk who are obviously from Africa, and these are probably black men. And then they mention a name that we really haven't heard before. It's Manian. And Manian is a foster son of Herod the Great. It was Herod the Great who tried to kill Jesus. If you remember, he killed all the young boys under the age of 2 in Bethlehem. Herod, who killed John the Baptist, is a foster brother of this man. So here's this man being brought up really as someone who is supposed to be very important, but someone who actually hates God. And Herod wasn't really a full Jew, and yet he was given to be king of the Jews. And so he was brought up anti-church, anti-God, anti-anything that might be seen as a threat against him. And then you've got Saul, who was very much anti-church. Saul, who was a Pharisee, who would have known all the rules of the Pharisees, and therefore he would not have dined with Gentiles. He would not have associated with Gentiles. And probably the first two men mentioned were probably Gentiles, as I say, from Africa. Here's a mixture of people that you would never have dreamt would have come together. A real mixture of backgrounds, of races, and maybe even of ages. Here they are forming the church at Antioch. What's the one thing that brings them together? Well, the one thing that brings them together often isn't it race or age or interest. What brings them together is they're all saved. They've all received salvation, and it's the salvation that God has given to them that has been able to bring them together. And when we saw our leaders stand, we've got a real bunch of mixed ages. Isn't that right? We've got Murray in the one extreme and somebody else in the other. I wouldn't have thought so, Sam. I was thinking of Celia, but never mind. Don't tell us that. And you know, and people with mixed backgrounds, with mixed interests, and yet they're all standing here today, and it's because God has brought them together. God has called them to serve. And actually, when you look at the church, it's the same. You know, we've got people here from all backgrounds. You've even got somebody from Glasgow here, and from all sorts of places. We would never be together if it was up to us. There's no way we would be together. There's nothing that would draw us together other than the fact that Christ has called us to be in this place. And that's really important for the Church at Antioch. The Church at Antioch was a really important church, and it became important in so many ways. And yet it was a mix of all sorts of people. But they saw themselves as the body of Christ. And because of that, they were a great blessing to the known world. And that is true for us. We are from mixed backgrounds, mixed interests. When I talk about football, some of you thought, oh, not football again. So when I told you about meeting Harry yesterday, the first time somebody thought, oh, no, he's not going to talk about football. And I'm not going to gloat that we won 3-0, so I'm not going to mention football. And but, you know, and people think, I hate football. And, oh, I hate Glaswegians, or whatever it might be. But the great thing, it's not the fact that we like football, that's why we're here. It's not because we all like being from Northern Ireland. That's not why we're here. We're here because Jesus loves us, and we love Jesus. He's called us to be his body here in Sydenham. We're from lots of different backgrounds, but we're here together. And that's what we have to focus on. The church at Antioch focused on who they are. They're the body of Christ. And their background, their history, is not particularly important. In fact, it wasn't important at all. What was important was their identity in Jesus. We are a new creation. The old has gone, Paul says. This is the new. And therefore, that's the first thing. As we look at our leaders and we think, they're a real mixed bunch of folk. And then we look at one another and we think, we're definitely a mixed bunch of folk. But our background, where we've come from, is not a bit important. What has happened in the past is not important. I mean, Saul murdered Christians before. None of that's important. What's important is that he's a believer in Christ and he belongs to the church. And that's what's important. Our background, what has happened in the past. We all might have regrets about things we've done in the past, though that's not important. What's important is who you are now in Jesus. The second thing is not only are they believers together, but they have been transformed. That's the point of coming to Jesus. When we come to Jesus, we were looking at last week, when we looked at the woman in Samaria, here was a woman that definitely had a history. But when she met with Jesus, when she had encountered Jesus, she was transformed. And so when she went back and told her neighbours and those she lived around, they couldn't believe what she was saying. And they said, we came and listened to this man because of what you say, but now we believe because of what we see. Her life was transformed by meeting Jesus. And this group of people, motley crew you could say, they were transformed into the church of Christ, into the body of Christ. Not because of their work, but because of the work of Jesus. That's what it means today. Is the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. And throughout many, many churches, there's Reformation Sunday. I thought that we wouldn't do it here. And the reason I thought we wouldn't do it here isn't because I thought the Reformation isn't important. Of course, it's vitally important. But every day for us is Reformation Sunday or Reformation Day. This idea is in Christ alone, by faith alone. That's who we are. We're transformed because of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done for us. And so when we look at our leaders, they're transformed. And that's why they're leaders in our youth organizations. When we look at one another, don't be saying, you used to. I mean, that's a very easy thing to say. But the past is gone. We are now transformed in Christ. And the third thing we noticed about these folk is they were getting ready. They were preparing to serve God. They spent time with God. They prayed and they fasted. In other words, they knew that God wanted them to do something. And so they saw God's face as to what to do. And so they prayed and they fasted, seeking God's face and what they should do, seeking God's will. Very often as a church, the temptation is to do something. And we can be busy doing lots of different things because that's what churches do. And therefore, we make sure we have a full calendar. We make sure that once you become a Christian, that you have no time to sin. And so we keep making sure you come down to church and we make sure that you're busy in church. And that's what we try to do. And that's absolute nonsense because that's not what we should be trying to do. And so rather than just doing things for the sake of it, we need to be saying, what does God want us to do? What does God want us to do? Because when we do what God wants us to do, then people will be transformed. Rather than doing what we think other churches do or what a church should do, we should be thinking, well, God, what do you want us to do? And so therefore, one of the most important meetings we have in the church, probably one of the best attended meetings is our morning service, but probably one of the most important meetings, of course, this is a really important meeting, of course it is the prayer meeting. Because the prayer meeting isn't where we come and tell God what we want, or that we even come and tell God what we're nervous about, or what we want God to bless, although we can do that. But surely part of the prayer meeting, maybe I'm at fault here as your minister, but we should be spending more time maybe in thinking, God, what do you want us to do? What should we be doing? How should the BB be run? What should the BB be doing? What should the Girls Brigade be doing? What should SID Kids be doing? What should the Youth Club be doing? What should the Hope Club be doing? Is there things that we should be doing rather than thinking, well, here's a program, we need to deliver it. Surely we should be spending more time, God, what should you be doing? And there's a Kirk session. Really, that's what we try at the beginning of our Kirk session. Every time we have a Kirk session meeting, we pray, Lord, help us to hear what you want us to do. And help us to have the courage to do it. In other words, the Kirk session is not about people coming together and sharing their great ideas. But it should be people coming together thinking, God, what would you have us to do? And there is the responsibility at the end of the Kirk session to lead the congregation in the way that God is calling. It's not for the Kirk session to decide where they should go, where we should go, and we should follow them. But it should be the Kirk session be saying, look, we believe God is saying to us, this is where we should be going. And so there should be time spent in preparation as we pray. And maybe sometimes as we fast, we're not always good at fasting. You can tell that I'm not good at fasting. But we should be spending time in prayer, seeking God's face for God to lead us. And then we see in verses 3 to 5 is that God dedicates through his church. When Saul at this stage, Saul and Barnabas and young John is heading out. This is our first missionary journey. It's the church that sends them. So it's the church who prays for them, lays hands on them and says, you go in our name. When missionaries go out, we have Dave and Helen in Pakistan. They're not going out because they thought this would be a great thing to do. Wouldn't it be lovely to go and live in Pakistan? The sun is always shining in Pakistan. The mosquitoes are always small in Pakistan. You know, they didn't go out there because they loved to be bitten by mosquitoes. That wasn't their idea of going. They didn't go out because they thought, wouldn't it be lovely if we could get a good tan in Pakistan? There's better places to go for a tan, I think, maybe. No, they went to Pakistan because they believed God had called them. And we as a church have sent them out. And thankfully, we're not the only church. I know that Dave's church has done that too. But there's a responsibility. But not only is there a responsibility, but for them, there's a sense of comfort that they've been sent out by the church of God. That they're not on their own. It's not there four wee individuals. There used to be only three, but there's now four. Four wee individuals messing about in Pakistan. That's not what it's about. But they've been sent. And so Saul and Barnabas and John are sent by the church. And they're going around and some of the things they do are really exciting. And some of the things they do are really dangerous. And some of the things they do are really quite disappointing. But they do it in the name of God, in the name of the church. And therefore our leaders are not sole workers. They do this on behalf of Christ, but they do it sent out by the church. And so the BB is as much part of the church as the morning service. The Girls Brigade is as part of the church as the morning service. The SID Kids and the Youth Club are as part of the church. And we need to always remember that, and it's an important part of that. And so therefore, maybe in the future, we might try and get some of our youth organizations to come into the church a bit more, because they're not separate from the church, but they're part of the church. But the most important thing is that they've been sent out by us, and therefore they're not on their own. And if they do ever feel on their own, then we apologize if we've made them feel like that, because it's all about working together in the name of Christ. And what's true is for youth organizations, it's true for anything that we do here, that we go out in the name of Christ. And our aim is to glorify him in all the things that we say and we do. But the best thing about this wee church, it was vibrant. It wasn't particularly big. It was full of lots of different people, but they had one thing in common, and they had Jesus as their Saviour. And because of that, they were transformed. Their past was no longer important. It's who they are now in Christ that was important. They were willing to prepare themselves by praying and fasting and spending time in God's presence. And they recognized that it's not individuals that do things, but the church do it. And these individuals do it in the name of the church, because it's through the church that God will bless this area. And therefore, we need to make sure as a church that we're ready for that. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you. We thank you again for your church. We thank you for this here, this church in Sydenham. We thank you that we're part of your living church in this world. We thank you, Lord, that you've called us into this place and we're here from various backgrounds and various races. But you call us to be one in you. Thank you, too, that we've all got a past. And it would be easy for anybody in this congregation to point to someone else in this congregation and say, do you remember they used to do this? Remember they used to say that? But we thank you that when we came to Jesus, we're transformed individuals. And our identity isn't in our past. Our identity isn't even in the jobs that we do. Our identity is in Jesus. And we thank you for that. But help us to be a church that prepares for blessing. And the way that we prepare for blessing is that we spend time in your presence. Particularly, Lord, as we're at home, but also together. Help us to be committed to pray and to seek your face. And help us to be willing, if you so choose us, to be willing to go. And for some, that might be to the youth organizations. But to others, it might be to Pakistan or Africa or somewhere else. But give us a willingness to hear your voice and to obey it. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So just a wee plug, the Hope Club's on next week. But the prayer meeting is on, so we haven't stopped for half term. I think that's because there's nobody in the prayer meeting who's still at school. Maybe that's why. And so therefore, if you're free, it'd be great to see 7 o'clock this Wednesday night at the prayer meeting. But let's continue to worship God as we present to him this morning our morning offerings. Our final hymn is a great GB hymn, and I'm not sure if there's such a thing as a GB hymn. We'll maybe find out for next year. But we're going to be singing, Will Your Anchor Hold? Let's stand as we worship.
Thank you.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and reign with each one of us now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.